Here we go. So never in history there were so many opportunities in fintech. It seems like there's a lot of convergence between technology, applications, geopolitical, Brexit. There's a lot of moving parts that suddenly allows a lot of small companies start to blend into the financial ecosystems. And we see it more and more and more. It's also one of the unique time in history where the regulators suddenly become much more flexible and encouraging for new players to come in and compete. And we see many examples in Europe and across the world. My name is Yuval Tal. I started two fintech companies, the first one in 1999 when we took it public in 2014, and the second one is Payoneer, which I will talk today. What Payoneer is doing in essence is allow two businesses in two countries to pay each other. It was done ever since history, but it took a whole different angle when e-commerce started to become relevant. And kind of, if you look at kind of the logic, we allow a company in the US to pay domestic systems as if it was a domestic company, and a company in China or in India or in Bangladesh or in Pakistan get their payments as if it was a domestic transaction. And when you start to look at the different payment systems in different countries, it becomes a pretty complicated spaghetti. So we build it. It was done before. Why couldn't bank do it? Banks do it, but banks tend to do local systems, and then they work with another bank in a different country. We build a system globally. And that takes a whole lot of complexity and work. Before we dive into the numbers and kind of how the mechanics get to be effective, a little bit about how it affects the people, the users. And it's actually quite fascinating. So if you look at the e-commerce, before e-commerce existed, it was all import and export. So you would go to the bank, you send a fax, you would do a wire transfer. But now, when you want to get a present for your spouse and his birthday card, and you go to Fiverr and you ask someone to give say a birthday party or a birthday present, or you get design a logo, or you want to get some kind of a software project or design project, you go to any other company and you know that someone in Indonesia can actually do the work. So you need an infrastructure of payments that can pay $20 and $200 and $500, and it's cost prohibitive to do it with banks, and it's too complicated. So when you go to Amazon, you buy a flashlight, you know that someone in China is making it, someone maybe in Israel is actually organizing the store, and the whole thing needs to actually move money between all those countries, and that's pretty complicated. So we allow and enabled a lot of businesses to exist that could not exist before that. And indeed, many of our customers didn't exist when we started. There's a whole ecosystem, and we hope to be part of the infrastructure of e-commerce that allows businesses to exist. A little bit of the company, so we could operate only from New York. It's an American-based company, and it's headquartered in New York. We could have operated only from New York and maybe R&D in Tel Aviv. But over time, we've found out that foot on the ground makes a very big difference, and we have offices in 20 countries. Once a year, we bring everybody to Israel, or to the US, or to UK, and we have one big party, and it's fascinating, and it's really cross-culture, and beautiful things happen then. Some numbers about the company, so about 1,200 employees. We service thousands and thousands of small businesses, not only businesses who need to pay, millions of other businesses. Some of the businesses that we pay are individual, like photographer who needs to get paid, and they typically get paid with a card or small transaction, but many of them are actually quite significant businesses. So there's a lot of B2B and a lot of B2B. We raised hundreds of millions of dollars. So I'm not going to go into it. I don't even remember, so sorry about that. We move tens of billions of dollars a year. The good thing about payment in general, the tens of billions of dollars a year is a lot, but it's insignificant compared to the overall payment market. Our revenues are in the hundreds of millions of dollars. We've been profitable since 2010. We are VC-backed, so there's only two ways out. Some of the assets we have, and this is when a company touches money, versus company who provides services like Forterra before, versus company who provides services to companies that touch money, one of the trickiest parts is to have bank partners. The fintech space is really closely cooperative with the banking system. And for a bank to accept a company that is touching the money, a money service business, it's a long process. To open an account at Citibank can take years. So having the bank relationship is a major asset for most fintech companies. This is obviously the show-off slide. So we have some of the companies. We have a company who sells books over here, and the rest of them. And I think the important part of that section of the slide is there's something about fintech, which is you need other fintech companies in order to succeed. In other words, if we would go to Amazon or Google and try to offer them and work with them, and we would only compete with banks, they probably wouldn't choose us. Because there's more fintech companies trying to win the business, suddenly it becomes legitimate for those companies to use fintech companies versus only banks. So there's something about the ecosystem of fintech that actually works well. We are a US company and we have offices in Israel, but there's something nice specifically about Islamabad when we have the conference twice a year, that it's beyond the geopolitical environment. And for some reason, when people do business globally, it's okay to work with everybody else. It's just somehow nice. The reason that we chose the business model, this is really the logic of why we do what we do. The reason we chose it is actually quite important for anyone who wants to start a company. First, we took a very complex market. It's really, really complex. There's no school to it. So when you trade risk and complexity, complexity wins. It brings you more assets over time. We're using existing rails. We didn't invent a new payment system. We're using all of the existing payment system out there. The association, the MasterCard Visa Network, the ACH, the Bux, the Gyro, the Synapse in China. China have three different systems. So in any country can pay domestically, and any other country can pay domestically. That, all those rails add up to be complex, but we didn't invent it. So we can riding the existing rails. We took the cross-border market, which is most generous. If you do domestic payments, it's very, very difficult to make money. When it's cross-border, you know it's going to be expensive, and then even if you reduce the price by a lot, you can still make money. We took a space that is actually easy to raise money, right? It's solid, you can show growth over time, so it's fairly, there's a lot of VC who wants to invest in the space. It's a space that has a lot of M&A, so there's a way out of it, right? There's also, a threshold of regulatory compliance, right? So you don't have the risk that someone come up with a new cute idea and can suddenly take your business away. And there's also, which is also very, very important, you don't have the winner takes it all situation, right? So if you look at Get in Tel Aviv, it's very difficult to get in. Uber in New York, it's very difficult to get in addition. You can have one more player, but it's difficult to have seven players. Payment doesn't have this winner takes it all thing. There is some network effect, but it adds up. Lastly, when you work in payments and you work in fintech in general, I think it's true for most, but I would use payments as an example. You take a group, and over time, you kind of develop ability to work together and kind of go deeper in the knowledge and the understanding. And when you suddenly have a group of hundreds or 200 of core people who understands the payment engine, you can have really, really nice things come out of that. And it's something I'm sure that other companies have it, but in fintech in specific, it's just very difficult. There's no school, so it's very difficult to get that. You can only find people from other companies in the space, and then you need to kind of learn together with them. But then when you do have the team, it's very, very powerful. I want to maybe leave with a note from my journey throughout the fintech and startup companies, and I would recommend for people who think of joining fintech startups, it's probably a very wise choice. I think it's very good timing. It can also, if you look at joining a company, it's beyond the terms, the payments, the salary, etc. You can join a group that collectively create value very quickly. There have been a lot of miracles recently in how quickly companies grow. And when you join a company and create value, it's very, very powerful. You change from a job to a career to something that defines you, and you may find, especially in fintech, because it requires people to be smart, you find out that you work with people that you really look up to and appreciate. Thank you very, very much.